have a longer term vision. And so therefore we kind of worry about the longer term first. And as a result, that does give us that tendency to look at emerging risks.
Once women are empowered, once they get the tools, when they are aware, once they are educated, they immediately become change agents.
It's maybe the first time in history that we can reconcile ecology and industry. This is maybe why all the projects that you are going to discover tonight with the momentum of change are projects that transform our vision of climate change.
I thank each of the award winners for their ingenuity and courage and wish you all much success.
Congratulate all of the winners tonight and invite you up here to take a picture for everyone. You're welcome to come to.
Nous voici donc presque au bout du chemin et sans doute au début d'un autre. Je veux d'abord vous remercier, toutes et tous. À chaque étape, l'objectif a été de nous rapprocher ensemble de l'accord souhaité par tous, de contenir l'augmentation de la température moyenne bien en deçà de 2 degrés et de s'efforcer de limiter cette augmentation à 1,5 degré.
We can look into the eyes of our children, our grandchildren, and we can finally say, tell them that we have joined hands to bequeath a more habitable world to them and to future generations.
It is an agreement of conviction. It is an agreement of solidarity with the most vulnerable. It is an agreement of long-term vision. Because it is an agreement of commitment to turn this new legal framework into the engine of safe growth for all for the rest of this century. We end this COP celebrating a new chapter of hope for the world.
Le 12 décembre 2015 restera une grande date pour la planète. À Paris, il y a eu bien des révolutions depuis des siècles. Mais aujourd'hui, c'est la plus belle et la plus pacifique des révolutions qui vient d'être accomplie, la révolution pour le changement climatique.
L'accord de Paris pour le climat est accepté.
Distinguished delegates, the eyes of the world have been on Paris for weeks. Now, the eyes of millions of people around the world are on you.
C'est un jour historique que nous vivons. La France accueille 150 chefs d'État et de gouvernement. C'est au nom de la justice climatique que je m'exprime aujourd'hui devant vous. C'est au nom de la justice climatique que nous devons agir.
You are here today to write the script for a new future. I urge you to answer with courage and vision. And I count on your strong leadership and commitment to make this world better for all.
Ensemble, faisons de la conférence de Paris le succès historique que le monde attend.
I'll be sharing a poem about the beauty of our islands and what we want the world to know, which is that we shouldn't have to move from our islands because of the flooding.
To you world leaders, this is a childish wake-up call. This is what will happen to a planet with too much CO2.
Your presence at the COP is important to remind us all, but it's also what you're doing at home. Because that is where the rubber hits the ground. That is where you can really make a true difference. So thank you for both.
So we want to show you how are young people going to be if we continue in the same path that we are right now.
I think every single person on this planet needs to be educated and re-educated about climate change. We are dedicated as the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change to embrace this education issue. And I would urge you to talk to your governments and make the point quite clearly that education is the most powerful weapon for delivery on climate change.
Plus de 100 villes de plus de 1 million d'habitants vont être construites dans les prochaines années. Il va falloir qu'on réduise les émissions dues aux bâtiments et à la construction.
En ce qui concerne l'action de la société, les choses sont lancées et comme l'ont dit mes camarades mousquetaires, l'action ne s'arrêtera plus. Ça va être la COP de l'action. C'est clair, c'est net.
So from Action Day to Action World.
Through Action COP.
Yay!
I'd like to ask you to join us in making a commitment and being under the scrutiny of our children in 10 years from today. So, with your help, here come the trees.
If you have a rooftop solar and an electric vehicle, today it's $1 a gallon equivalent.
In the history of humanity, there have been many great moral causes that have asked us to choose between what is right and what is wrong. The right choice is to safeguard the future for the next generation and for the generations to come. Yes, we will change.
Le rassemblement des maires que nous avons eu hier est un rassemblement historique, sans précédent, pour agir. Nous avons pris des engagements concrets. Par exemple, cet engagement de faire en sorte, nous les maires, que dans nos villes, à horizon de 2050, 100% de l'énergie soit de l'énergie renouvelable.
Today, as never before, the stars are aligned in favor of a strong, concerted action on climate change.
Nous y sommes presque. Nous avons fait l'essentiel du chemin. Il nous reste encore quelques foulées pour atteindre le point d'arrivée. Mais cette journée, l'Action Day, nous donne justement l'impulsion, là encore, nécessaire.
This conference here in Paris is going to bring results because I think enough people are now directly affected by what's happening that they want to see change. The young people of today are very concerned about the environment. And I think they have the intelligence and the will and the passion to do something about it. Let them manage what's left of this earth. That's how I feel.
Welcome to Momentum for Change, Women for Results.
I think women tend to have a longer term vision. And so therefore we kind of worry about the longer term first. And as a result, that does give us that tendency to look at emerging risks.
Once women are empowered, once they get the tools, when they are aware, once they are educated, they immediately become change agents.
It's maybe the first time in history that we can reconcile ecology and industry. This is maybe why all the projects that you are going to discover tonight with the momentum of change are projects that transform our vision of climate change.
I thank each of the award winners for their ingenuity and courage, and wish you all much success.
Congratulate all of the winners tonight and invite you up here to take a picture for everyone. You're welcome to come to.
Nous voici donc presque au bout du chemin et sans doute au début d'un autre. Je veux d'abord vous remercier, toutes et tous. À chaque étape, l'objectif a été de nous rapprocher ensemble de l'accord souhaité par tous, de contenir l'augmentation de la température moyenne bien en deçà de 2 degrés et de s'efforcer de limiter cette augmentation à 1,5 degré.
We can look into the eyes of our children, our grandchildren, and we can finally say, tell them that we have joined hands to bequeath a more habitable world to them and to future generations.
It is an agreement of conviction. It is an agreement of solidarity with the most vulnerable. It is an agreement of long-term vision. Because it is an agreement of commitment to turn this new legal framework into the engine of safe growth for all for the rest of this century. We end this COP celebrating a new chapter of hope for the world.
Le 12 décembre 2015 restera une grande date pour la planète. À Paris, il y a eu bien des révolutions depuis des siècles. Mais aujourd'hui, c'est la plus belle et la plus pacifique des révolutions qui vient d'être accomplie, la révolution pour le changement climatique.
L'accord de Paris pour le climat est accepté.
Distinguished delegates, the eyes of the world have been on Paris for weeks. Now, the eyes of millions of people around the world are on you.
C'est un jour historique que nous vivons.
La France accueille 150 chefs d'État et de gouvernement. C'est au nom de la justice climatique que je m'exprime aujourd'hui devant vous. C'est au nom de la justice climatique que nous devons agir.
You are here today to write a script for a new future. I urge you to answer with courage and vision. And I count on your strong leadership and commitment to make this world better for all.
Ensemble, faisons de la conférence de Paris le succès historique que le monde attend.
I'll be sharing a poem about the beauty of our islands and what we want the world to know, which is that we shouldn't have to move from our islands because of the flooding.
To you world leaders, this is a childish wake-up call. This is what will happen to a planet with too much CO2.
Your presence at the COP is important to remind us all, but it's also what you're doing at home, because that is where the rubber hits the ground. That is where you can really make a true difference. So thank you for both.
So we want to show you how are young people going to be if we continue in the same path that we are right now.
I think every single person on this planet needs to be educated and re-educated about climate change. We are dedicated as the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change to embrace this education issue. And I would urge you to talk to your governments and make the point quite clearly that education is the most powerful weapon for delivery on climate change.
Plus de 100 villes de plus de 1 million d'habitants vont être construites dans les prochaines années. Il va falloir qu'on réduise les émissions dues aux bâtiments et à la construction.
En ce qui concerne l'action de la société, les choses sont lancées. Et comme l'ont dit mes camarades mousquetaires, l'action ne s'arrêtera plus. Ça va être la COP de l'action. C'est clair, c'est net.
So from Action Day to Action World.
Through Action COP.
Yay!
I'd like to ask you to join us in making a commitment and being under the scrutiny of our children in 10 years from today. So, with your help, here come the trees.
If you have a rooftop solar and an electric vehicle, today it's $1 a gallon equivalent.
In the history of humanity, there have been many great moral causes that have asked us to choose between what is right and what is wrong. The right choice is to safeguard the future for the next generation and for the generations to come. Yes, we will change.
Le rassemblement des maires que nous avons eu hier est un rassemblement historique, sans précédent, pour agir. Nous avons pris des engagements concrets. Par exemple, cet engagement de faire en sorte, nous les maires, que dans nos villes, à horizon de 2050, 100% de l'énergie soit de l'énergie renouvelable.
Today, as never before, the stars are aligned in favor of a strong, concerted action on climate change.
Nous y sommes presque. Nous avons fait l'essentiel du chemin. Il nous reste encore quelques foulées pour atteindre le point d'arrivée. Mais cette journée, l'Action Day, nous donne justement l'impulsion, là encore, nécessaire.
This conference here in Paris is going to bring results because I think enough people are now directly affected by what's happening that they want to see change. Young people of today are very concerned about the environment, and I think they have the intelligence and the will and the passion to do something about it. Let them manage what's left of this earth. That's how I feel.
Welcome to Momentum for Change, Women for Results.
I think women tend to have a longer term vision. And so therefore we kind of worry about the longer term first. And as a result, that does give us that tendency to look at emerging risks.
Once women are empowered, once they get the tools, when they are aware, once they are educated, they immediately become change agents.
It's maybe the first time in history that we can reconcile ecology and industry. This is maybe why all the projects that you are going to discover tonight with the momentum of change are projects that transform our vision of climate change.
I thank each of the award winners for their ingenuity and courage, and wish you all much success.
Thank you. I'd like to congratulate all of the winners tonight and invite you up here to take a picture for everyone. You're welcome to come to.
Nous voici donc presque au bout du chemin et sans doute au début d'un autre. Je veux d'abord vous remercier, toutes et tous. À chaque étape, l'objectif a été de nous rapprocher ensemble de l'accord souhaité par tous, de contenir l'augmentation de la température moyenne bien en deçà de 2 degrés et de s'efforcer de limiter cette augmentation à 1,5 degré.
We can look into the eyes of our children, our grandchildren, and we can finally say, tell them that we have joined hands to bequeath a more habitable world to them and to future generations.
It is an agreement of conviction. It is an agreement of solidarity with the most vulnerable. It is an agreement of long-term vision. Because it is an agreement of commitment to turn this new legal framework into the engine of safe growth for all for the rest of this century. We end this COP celebrating a new chapter of hope for the world.
Le 12 décembre 2015 restera une grande date pour la planète. À Paris, il y a eu bien des révolutions depuis des siècles. Mais aujourd'hui, c'est la plus belle et la plus pacifique des révolutions qui vient d'être accomplie, la révolution pour le changement climatique.
L'accord de Paris pour le climat est accepté.
Distinguished delegates, the eyes of the world have been on Paris for weeks. Now, the eyes of millions of people around the world are on you.
C'est un jour historique que nous vivons.
La France accueille 150 chefs d'État et de gouvernement. C'est au nom de la justice climatique que je m'exprime aujourd'hui devant vous. C'est au nom de la justice climatique que nous devons agir.
You are here today to write the script for a new future. I urge you to answer with courage and vision. And I count on your strong leadership and commitment to make this world better for all.
Ensemble, faisons de la conférence de Paris le succès historique que le monde attend.
I'll be sharing a poem about the beauty of our islands and what we want the world to know, which is that we shouldn't have to move from our islands because of the flooding.
To you world leaders, this is a childish wake-up call. This is what will happen to a planet with too much CO2.
Your presence at the COP is important to remind us all, but it's also what you're doing at home, because that is where the rubber hits the ground. That is where you can really make a true difference. So thank you for both.
So we want to show you how our young people going to be if we continue in the same path that we are right now.
I think every single person on this planet needs to be educated and re-educated about climate change. We are dedicated as the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change to embrace this education issue. And I would urge you to talk to your governments and make the point quite clearly that education is the most powerful weapon for delivering on climate change.
Plus de 100 villes de plus de 1 million d'habitants vont être construites dans les prochaines années. Il va falloir qu'on réduise les émissions dues aux bâtiments et à la construction.
En ce qui concerne l'action de la société, les choses sont lancées. Et comme l'ont dit mes camarades mousquetaires, l'action ne s'arrêtera plus. Ça va être la COP de l'action. C'est clair, c'est net.
So from Action Day to Action World.
Through Action COP.
Yay!
I'd like to ask you to join us in making a commitment and being under the scrutiny of our children in 10 years from today. So, with your help, here come the trees.
If you have rooftop solar and an electric vehicle, today it's $1 a gallon equivalent.
In the history of humanity, there have been many great moral causes that have asked us to choose between what is right and what is wrong. The right choice is to safeguard the future for the next generation and for the generations to come. Yes, we will change.
Le rassemblement des maires que nous avons eu hier est un rassemblement historique, sans précédent, pour agir. Nous avons pris des engagements concrets. Par exemple, cet engagement de faire en sorte, nous les maires, que dans nos villes, à horizon de 2050, 100% de l'énergie soit de l'énergie renouvelable.
Today, as never before, the stars are aligned in favor of a strong, concerted action on climate change.
Nous y sommes presque. Nous avons fait l'essentiel du chemin. Il nous reste encore quelques foulées pour atteindre le point d'arrivée. Mais cette journée, l'Action Day, nous donne justement l'impulsion là encore nécessaire.
This conference here in Paris is going to bring results because I think enough people are now directly affected by what's happening, that they want to see change. The young people of today are very concerned about the environment, and I think they have the intelligence and the will and the passion to do something about it. Let them manage what's left of this earth. That's how how I feel.
Kamu bisa nikmatin berbagai informasi dari Liputan 6, liputan6.com, dan aplikasi Liputan 6 secara bersamaan. Semuanya ada di wajah baru aplikasi Liputan 6. Kamu bisa jadi orang yang paling cepat dapat informasi terbaru karena ada fitur latest. Nikmati cara baru baca berita di fitur visual stories. Bukan cuma tulisannya yang menarik, tapi banyak gambar kece yang bisa kamu lihat. Tampilan kece, update berita cepat. Download sekarang ya. Kamu bisa nikmatin berbagai informasi dari Liputan 6, liputan6.com, dan aplikasi Liputan 6 secara bersamaan. Semuanya ada di wajah baru aplikasi Liputan 6. Kamu bisa jadi orang yang paling cepat dapat informasi terbaru karena ada fitur latest. Nikmati cara baru baca berita di fitur visual stories. Bukan cuma tulisannya yang menarik, tapi banyak gambar kece yang bisa kamu lihat. Tampilan kece, update berita cepat. Download sekarang ya.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the 18 Economix International Dialogue. Before we begin today's seminar, let me introduce myself. My name is Thomas Cesariano, Economix Student Batch 2020. And now, I will guide you through today's seminar as your master of ceremony. Before we begin today's seminar, please abide by the following rules. Participants are strictly forbidden to make a hassle or make a potentially problematic situation. Participants are not allowed to spam the chat column. Participants are not allowed to activate the camera or the mic during the webinar. Link for the presence form will be shared at the end of each session. Participants can ask questions through Zoom chat or YouTube live chat using format name underscore institution underscore question. Economix is one of the biggest international events in the Faculty of Economics and Business, University of Indonesia. This event is annually held by Kanopi, the student body of University of Indonesia undergraduate economics students. Economix regularly serves as a platform for the discussion of crucial global economic issues. In its 18th year, Economix returned with the grand theme of The Planet and Climate Crisis, Repercussion of Ignorance. Before we go to the next agenda, we would like to thank our media partners. Without their contribution, our event will not be as successful. In particular, we would like to thank Kumparan, Liputan 6, Merdeka.com, Info Seminar, Event Campus, and last but not least, Kontan. Ladies and gentlemen, to start off our seminar, we will hear an opening speech from the 18 Economix Chief Executive Officer. Please welcome Kevin Bagas Satria.
Good evening, honorable speakers, moderator, and fellow attendees. My name is Kevin Bagas Satria, serving as the Chief Executive Officer of the 18th Economix Global Economic Challenges, and I proudly welcome you to the Economix International Dialogue. For most of the year, the coronavirus pandemic has become the headline. It is undeniable that the pandemic has brought so much misery and threat towards humanity. However, we must not be deceived, and we should realize that a much bigger threat lies in the climate crisis. The average global temperature has risen faster than ever in the last few years, and scientists are debating whether or not to have passed the point of no return. A glimpse of hope emerged in 2015, when 195 countries came to Paris to sign on the Paris Agreement to limit the rise of global average temperature by 2 degrees Celsius compared to pre-industrial times by the year 2100. Countries are expected to abide by the agreement and direct its emission policies through its nationally determined contributions, or NDC. However, certain countries, such as Indonesia, is still deemed highly insufficient in its NDCs. Moreover, the world's politics have evolved. As we have seen in the USA's withdrawal from the agreement during the Trump administration. In this webinar, we are going to listen, discuss, and gain valuable understanding surrounding these issues. With our honor speakers, Mr. Daniel Krieger of Association of Climate Change Officers, Professor Edwin Aldrian of Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, and Prof. Budi Reso Sudarmo of Arne Korden, Department of Economics, Australia National University. Finally, on behalf of the committee, I wish you all a pleasant and insightful evening towards the betterment of the planet. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin Bagastatria, for the welcoming speech. Next, we will hear a welcoming speech from the Canopy FABUI Chairman. Please welcome Abdul Ghani Kusuma.
Thank you, MC. Good evening. Greetings to one and all. My name is Abdul Ghani Kusuma, and I speak on behalf of an organizer, Economics Committee, and Canopy FABUI Student Association. Before we get started, I would like to express my gratitude to all of you who attend this international seminar and dialogue. Special thanks and appreciation also expressed to all of the speakers who sparing your precious time in the midst of activity. Welcome to our panel dialogue, dear Mr. Daniel Krieger, Professor Budi Reso Sudarmo, Professor Edwin Aldrian, and also the moderator Nathaniel Rice too. It's such an honor for us to having all of you to become our speakers. Hopefully this seminar and dialogue which addressing climate change issue will be insightful for our knowledge and making ourselves more aware and concerned about this global issue. I think that's all from me. Once again, thank you and enjoy the dialogue.
Thank you, Abdul Ghani Kusuma, for the welcoming speech. Now, we will hear an opening remark from Faith Adedison, PhD, as the head of Economics Department, the Faculty of Economics and Business, University of Indonesia. Please welcome Mr. Faith Adedison.
Okay, thank you, MC. Sorry for having long hair. Good evening, good day, good morning for all the participants from various countries. I'm honored to give a welcoming remark on this webinar of the 18th Economics, Global Economic Challenge. This event is an annual event held by our students at the Faculty of Economics and Business University of Indonesia, which consists of several activities. And due to the global pandemic, this is the first time that we have this event online. The topic of this webinar is very relevant to what we are experiencing anywhere in this world. So as the head of economics department, I would like to express my highest appreciation to all the resource persons, Mr. Daniel Krieger and Mr. Edwin Aldrian for making your time for this event. I also thank Mr. Rayestu as the moderator. So I hope you all learn, all the participants will learn valuable lessons from the resource persons. That's from me and have a good webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Faith Adedison, for the opening remark. The next session will be moderated by Mr. Nathaniel Raistu Abdul Rahman. Nathaniel Raistu Abdul Rahman is the podcast host of Asumsi Bersuara from Asumsi.co. He achieved his Bachelor of Economics degree from University of Indonesia in 2009. Currently, he is a product manager at one of the biggest education technology-based startups in Indonesia. Please give a warm welcome to Nathaniel Raistu Abdul Rahman.
Thank you, Riano. Thank you, Canopy, of the Department of Economics, Universitas Indonesia, for inviting me over. Hello, Pafit. Thank you for being here.
Hello,
I'm really
Nathaniel.
Yeah, I'm really excited and honored to moderate this evening's event, where we'll be discussing the future of the landmark climate crisis deal of our time, the Paris Agreement. Maybe a little recap. The Paris Agreement, 196 countries pledged to reduce emissions, aiming to limit the global temperature increases to 1.5 degrees this century, or 2 degrees since pre-industrial level. Now, under this agreement, countries are required to determine, plan, and regularly report their progress in achieving their emissions targets. Now, we'll be discussing this and more regarding our fight against the climate crisis. We'll talk about the agreement's implementations. Are we on track? How committed are countries on meeting the targets they set themselves? What about Indonesia? And what about other Southeast Asian countries? What about green technology, renewable energy? What are effective policies that countries can implement to help with the climate crisis? Maybe we can dig a little deeper into all of these with our excellent lineup of speakers tonight. So I'm pleased to introduce our three distinguished speakers for this evening's discussion. First, we have Daniel Krieger, co-founder and executive director of the Association of Climate Change Officers. Welcome, Daniel. Mr. Krieger has vast experience establishing partnerships and collaborating with federal agencies, environmental nonprofits, academic institutions, and multinational corporations, and is uniquely familiar, has unique familiarity of key climate change and sustainability efforts by most Fortune 500 companies, top government contractors, and government entities. Great to have you with us, Daniel.
Thank you for having me.
Our second speaker is Professor Edwin Aldrian, Professor of Meteorology and Climatology at the Agency for Assessment and Application of Technology in Indonesia, or BPPT. Prof. Edwin, welcome, Prof.
Okay, welcome, everyone. I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. Professor Edwin currently serves as IPCC WG1 Vice Chair, representing Indonesia and countries in the Southwest Pacific region. He obtained his PhD in 2003 from Max Planck Institute for Meteorology, Germany. He has published dozens of peer-reviewed studies in national and international scientific publications. His works are mainly on global and regional climate issues. Happy to have you here, Pak.
I'm also happy to be here.
And our third speaker is Professor Budi Resosudarmo. Prof. Budi is a developmental and environmental economist professor at the Australian National University. Prof. Budi, thanks for joining us, Pak. I know it's 11 p.m. there, right?
Yeah, thank you very much for inviting me. Happy to be here.
Thank you for joining us this late in the evening, Pak. Professor Budi is currently a member of the board of East Asian Association for Environmental and Resource Economics and a member of the advisory committee of the Economic and Environmental Institute in Indonesia. Since the 1990s, he has published numerous studies on the impacts of energy, air pollution, and climate change policies on the local economy and human welfare and health conditions. Thank you so much, Prof. Budi, for being here with us. So, without further ado, Daniel Krieger will be our first speaker. So, Mr. Krieger, you have 20 minutes. The floor is yours.
Great. Well, thank you very much. Let's see if it looks like, I guess you're sharing my screen. Excellent. All right. So, if I want to move forward, am I controlling this while you're sharing the screen, or do I just tell you to advance it? Just want to make sure that I do this smoothly.
You can tell us to advance it, sir.
Okay, great. All right, super. Well, again, thank you very much for welcoming me in, and good morning from sunny and now cold South Florida in the United States, where we are experiencing what we consider to be a cold front, which many would consider to be a heat wave in other parts of the world. So just a little bit of background for context as to who we are and the perspective that I'll be sharing with you, because my worldview is probably a lot different than most people running climate change NGOs around the world. I see things through a human capital lens, but we've been working at the policy landscape and thinking through what kind of workforce we need to have in this world in order to tackle this challenge of a changing planet that we're inducing. So if you could go ahead and move on to the next slide, please. Great. So a little bit about background, by the Association of Climate Change Officers by background. We were established about 12 years ago in 2008. We saw an emerging number of organizations in the public and private sectors who had made climate change commitments or had tasked people in their organizations with leading climate or sustainability initiatives. And whether they were in the public sector or the private sector, we asked, who are these people? 5 minutes ago, there wasn't somebody whose charge was leading a climate change initiative in an organization. And we thought, well, we need to standardize and advance this occupation. And we define that occupation as the person who's asking the question, how does climate change affect my organization's operations and or mission and or marketplace? And what do we do in response to that? And very shortly after standing up the organization, we realized, well, not only is there this whole new occupation of people who are leading and supporting climate change initiatives and organizations, but also there's the integration of climate change into numerous other occupations. And that meant that not only were we dealing with the vertical of climate change leadership, but we were talking about the horizontal of climate change integration into fields like civil engineering and planning and supply chain management and energy management and city and county management and budget and finance professionals. So as an organization, we're a community of practice, we're a credentialing body, we provide a lot of education and training. Over the last 10 years, we've done more research on the state of the climate change workforce than any other organization probably on the planet. And we've been numerous times contracted to administer governmental programs here in the United States. Most recently, we were contracted by the state of Maryland to run the U.S.'s first state-run climate change academy. And to our knowledge, it may very well be the first in the world, looking at building a climate-smart workforce throughout the state. So we're an organization that sees ourselves as defining, developing, and supporting the functions, the resources, and the communities that are necessary for organizational leadership in addressing climate-related risks and opportunities. We think that the pathway towards success on climate change is building a workforce that can actually do this. We are moving to another planet while staying here, and we have to learn how to thrive on the one that we're moving into and not the one we used to be in. Go ahead to the next slide. So as a community, we have three bodies that you can think of involved in the sort of work that we do. We've got people who primarily identify themselves as green space or environmental professionals, sustainability, resilience, climate change, maybe corporate responsibility and clean energy. But we also have folks involved in our community who are in command and control roles, whether they're elected officials or C-suite executives or city and county managers. And then we have people who would self-identify as primarily being in other fields of practice, those supply chain managers, as planners, as budget and finance professionals. So that's a little bit of background about ACO. Moving forward, if we can move to the next slide, please. So I think when we talk about adoption of the Paris Agreement and the paradigm shift that is going to be required to move forward, we need to understand how we got here, where we are, and what that road ahead looks like. So if you can move to the next slide, please. So let's start with some fundamentals of the UNFCCC, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. So the UNFCCC is an international treaty that was designed to measure and stabilize global greenhouse gases being emitted by at the individual country level. But it's important to know those the key attributes of that treaty, which is also the body that enforces the treaty. There are no mandatory reductions in the UNFCCC, and there are no legal or enforcement mechanisms. And the reason there are no mandatory reductions or legal enforcement mechanisms is because the United Nations as a whole doesn't have that capacity, right? So it is a body that brings people together and they may agree and commit to actions, but there's no enforcement capability. And so then the only way to move forward with enforcement is countries holding each other accountable, but the body itself doesn't have the ability to enforce. Now, the other thing to note here is that it was always structured to be an evolving, living, breathing, maturing process. That is what timing for data updates means. Meaning, ultimately, they knew that one agreement was not going to solve this challenge. And so it started the process of getting inventories in. It started the process of annual negotiations, but it was not intended to be a silver bullet solution towards tackling climate change. Next slide, please. And it's also important to understand what are the key negotiating issues that are at the heart of these negotiations on an annual basis. So let's oversimplify this, right? At the heart of 200 countries negotiating on how to tackle this challenge is the argument of who caused the problem versus who's going to be the biggest polluter going forward. Okay, let's start with historically the biggest polluter in the world, historically the United States from 1870 to date. Going forward, the largest greenhouse gas polluter in the world currently is China. developing nations are accelerating their emissions growth. And then part of these arguments are also who's going to be harmed. Maybe it's the islands of Micronesia or countries that don't have the infrastructure or the economies to withstand these challenges and the increasing frequency and magnitude of the disasters that are taking place. Disproportionately, we see casualties and disaster events in Asia versus other continents on the planet. And how do we address those harms? Can we? Can you address a country that will cease to exist in decades because it is underwater? How do you make that argument for reparation when they're not going to exist? And how can countries who are working to industrialize, to develop their economies today, how do they skip the historical approach to industrialization that got us here? And how do countries work together while protecting their own economies and protecting their sovereignty? These are all big, big parts of the issues. And when the UNFCCC was originally structured, it envisioned countries in classifications, those that were developing and vulnerable, those that were least developed, those who had been historically the greatest polluters and had the economies to actually help those who couldn't, and to then try to split them amongst those groups and drive policies based off of that. Next slide. So 5 years after the UNFCCC, we see our first effort at a mandated reduction, and that's the Kyoto Protocol. And it set its first mandatory emission limits. And I put these in quotes because the reality is, again, no enforcement mechanisms. So in Kyoto, you've got a top-down commitment area. And it's important to see right here, 1997 is the timeframe that was adopted, but the first reduction period starting 11 years later. Right, recognizing how much time it was going to take to get this thing off the ground. And initially, you had 37 countries exceeding about a 5% reduction target from the 1990 levels. But ultimately, the United States could not get its Congress to ratify this treaty, despite presidential support. And ultimately, the U.S. was not a signatory to this treaty. And when the U.S. withdrew, Canada subsequently withdrew from it, the U.S.'s largest trading partner. And then in the second commitment periods, you see Japan, New Zealand, and Russia decline to take on their reduction commitments. And the consequence of that is from the gate, right out of the gate, your countries that are involved in Kyoto only account for about 14% of global emissions. And for the entirety of the time that Kyoto was in effect, it was dead on arrival. It was never going to accomplish what we needed it to accomplish. It got the wheels turning. It got process started, but it was never going to be enough. That brings us forward to 2009, which I don't have on screen here, and the Copenhagen Accord, where the world descended upon Copenhagen because you had a President Barack Obama in the United States and a Congress that had passed, a U.S. Congress that had passed a cap and trade bill. And there was this worldwide thought that you were going to finally get a bigger, comprehensive, more aggressive and ambitious agreement. And ultimately, that didn't happen for a variety of reasons that had nothing to do with the United States. Then we move forward to 2015. The politics in the United States has changed, and the world becomes aware that, and the UNFCCC becomes aware that a top-down approach with treaty signatures is not going to work. And we move to a bottom-up approach where countries contribute. They submit their own plans. They have the flexibility. We move from a top-down to a bottom-up. And countries who sign on to the agreement say, we will make our own commitments, use our own structures, and develop our own national emissions targets and implement them. And that moves us forward to the Paris Agreement where we are today. Now let's look at what that means. And if you can move on to the next slide, please. So what's different this time from where we were in Kyoto to where we are today? Because shortly after the Paris Agreement is adopted, there's a leadership change in the United States, and you might start to think, well, shoot, if the U.S. is going to pull away as it did in Kyoto, what does that mean globally? And sure enough, President Donald Trump, within months of taking office, says we're pulling out of Paris, says the economic burden to the U.S. taxpayer is unreasonable. But this time, you get a big backlash. All of a sudden, you see hundreds of Fortune 500 company executives condemning the withdrawal. You see mayors and governors across the United States saying, we stand with the Paris Agreement. You see movements like the US Climate Alliance, climate mayors, the We're Still In movement. And then you also see G7 and G20 world leaders begin to pressure the United States. This was not happening before. And sure enough, you get an election a few weeks ago, and yes, it is finally resolved. You have Joe Biden now as the incoming president-elect of the United States. And already he has announced that John Kerry will be his climate czar. And this is important for Paris because John Kerry is one of the drivers and authors of the Paris Agreement back in 2015 when he was Secretary of State in the United States. And so that signifies to the world that the US is back on a leadership change stage. But let's be clear, I don't know that that mattered because the world had already determined this time it was moving forward. Although I think the world will move forward faster and more significantly with the US in a leadership role than in an isolation stance. Next slide. So here's where we are in the trajectory of addressing our emissions globally. As of 1990, 19 countries had peaked their emissions and were in a decline. And that means 21% at that point of global emissions were covered by that peaking. As we move forward to today in 2020, we're at 53 countries who've peaked their emissions. And it's projected by the UN that 57 countries will have peaked their emissions by 2030, accounting for 60% of global emissions. That's actually a really good story to tell. And it's important to very specifically note that China, in a time frame that was aligned with the Paris Agreement and happened just before the Paris Agreement, committed to peak its carbon dioxide emissions by 2030 or earlier. And it also committed to lower its intensity of emissions per unit of GDP by nearly 2/3. And the big transformation that really came from this was that it's committed to sourcing 20% of its energy from low carbon sources, which really has driven a substantial transformation in the market for clean energy technology. And so that commitment is a big difference from where we were 5, 10, 15 years ago. Next slide. But as we track our global, progress, I'm sorry, I'm a little tongue twisted this morning, as we track our global progress, this is still not enough, right? We can see very clearly through the various assessments that have been done, you can consult Climate Action Tracker, for example, to see how countries' commitments and implementation aligns with what is needed. And as you can see quite visually, we are not there yet. So while we may have a structure in a bottom-up approach that will get there, we do not have current commitments and implementation that are in line with what the science says we need to achieve. Next slide. So we're going to have to ratchet up what we do. And amongst the things that I think you will see scaled up over the next few years at the international level is more coordinated and substantial investments in clean energy technology. I think you're going to see momentum behind developing geoengineering solutions, as controversial as they are likely going to need to be explored at a governmental level and at scale. One of the challenges that the Paris Agreement created is by moving to a bottom-up approach is we lost our emissions markets. We lost global emissions markets. And now we have countries and subnational entities that have their own emissions markets. We're going to have to find a way to connect the dots. This was something that was always envisioned with Paris, but that they've really struggled with. And that requires developing standards that traverse jurisdictions, a way to link not just quality, but create the financial exchanges. And we're also going to have to get better decision support resources. Our climate science is decades ahead of our economic sciences in the context of climate change. And ultimately, we are going to need to be able to have the tools to drive informed investments and policies. We're not there yet. Projections on impacts on GDP are not actionable, right? We have to get to a better point than that. And ultimately, and this is our theory of change as ACO, is if we want to do this, commitments will not get us the way. You can have whatever GHG reduction commitments you want, We believe if you don't have an army of people with the skills to do this work, that we will not be able to achieve this transformation. Next slide. So let's talk about building a climate smart workforce, because that's at the core of what ACO has done for 12 years and the recommendations that we put forward. And that's looking at advancing the occupation of climate leadership and the integration of climate change into other occupations. Next slide. So ACO has done an enormous amount of research on the state of our field. And what we found across organizations across the world is there are no consistent centralized leadership structures on climate change, nor any dominant patterns of governance or leadership. Employers who do have substantial efforts working on climate change make no distinction between those who are leaders and others who are supporting in the context of their job and performance expectations. There are no adopted or recognizable professional credentials, though we administer the certified climate change professional credential and hope you all will consider pursuing them. HR organizations don't understand yet what HR, human resource organizations, don't yet actually understand what climate change means for a workforce or what skills are needed. And consistently we hear from those practitioners and organizations that their barriers to driving institutional action are budgetary restrictions, competing priorities, deficiency of technical skills, and a lack of standardization and established or accepted best practices. So we have to tackle these challenges. Next slide. So our themes here is, as we've seen, is that preparedness and resilience has historically resulted from reaction. We struggle around the world with being proactive about this. And really what climate change is a series of if-then statements. If we think this will happen, then these are the things that we must do. If this takes place, what does that mean for us? And what we see is across sectors, across organizations, we see wildly different paces and practices taking place. And our challenges in deploying resiliency measures are those literacy and preparedness competencies that need to be systemically advanced, and standardization and leveraging of data and risk. And so what that translates into is better finance skills, understanding of legal, insurance and liability, project management, public policy and shaping it, risk management and enterprise risk management and emergency management, and better systems thinking. And from a behavioral level, climate change doesn't recognize jurisdictions or silos. And so collaboration, communication, facilitation, initiative, and motivation are all important skills we need to work on behaviorally. Next slide. And at the core of that means we have to ask who needs to know what, because the answer is not everybody needs to know and do the same thing. Right? So if you're a supply chain manager, your intersection with climate change is patently different than if you're a civil engineer, which is patently different than if you're an energy manager. And so we have to figure out what those competency frameworks are, and we need fields to require that and employers to require that of those people, those practitioners and those professionals. Next slide. And so that means we have to also think about, well, what are the roles who need to have some level of either awareness, knowledge and literacy, or competency across roles like siting or design and engineering or planning or risk management or regulatory and policy making. Next slide. And that means that ultimately we're going to have to work on getting climate change into the DNA of decision making. The world is changing around us. And so this isn't just about the planet. It's not saving the planet. It's the things that we value. What do we value? We value our health. We value our security. We value our economic vitality. Those are the cases. And so we need to integrate climate change efforts into those core values in all organizations. Next slide. So for 18 months, we partnered with the International Society of Sustainability Professionals to explore, well, what's holding the field back? So I gave you the diagnostics of where we are. And ultimately, what through this 18-month adventure, which you can read the full report on at ecoissp.org/proceedings, is that climate change professionals must develop better leadership, systems thinking, and communication skills. I'm sorry, we're picking up some feedback there from someone else speaking. Is that climate change professionals need to have better leadership and system thinking and communication skills. This is not just an environmental challenge, it is an organizational and leadership challenge, that we need better allies across other fields of practice to work with, that we've got to get better data collection and analysis and informed decision-making resources, that policymakers need to play a role in shaping the market demand. Most employers do not demand professional expertise or wouldn't know what to demand of people they're hiring or employing. We need to systemically advance skills and literacy development across the workforce in the same way that we might for, say, protecting our workforce from cybersecurity challenges or workplace harassment challenges. And that we need to address systemic barriers related to equity and inclusion as a key component of climate action. Next slide. AECO over the last few years has done an enormous amount of not just research, but surveying large numbers of employees in big organizations to get an understanding of what their organizational culture is. And if you want to be able to build organization-wide readiness, you need to understand what the workforce thinks and how it intersects with these issues. And so here's an example of a subnational government entity in the United States that we did an assessment of more than 2,000 of their 8,500 employees from the very top of the organization to the bottom and across all levels and across the whole horizontal, all silos and agencies of the county. And what you can see that's really interesting here as an example is that there are less people who think strongly that climate change will affect their community in the future than think it's impacting them today. If you don't understand that, it's not intuitive. You wouldn't necessarily think that. If you don't understand that they think it's happening today, but that it doesn't affect their own health, then there's a gap. And there are opportunities to address this by diagnosing. Next slide. You can also get that in understanding their accountability. So here you can see that 58% of these employees feel that they should, that so strongly about climate change that they should reduce their footprint. But when you ask them, should they talk with their family or incorporate it into their work or work more collaboratively with peers or seek out continuing education or help their neighbors, look how substantially those numbers drop from the reducing their own footprint to working collaboratively or getting better at this. Next slide. And then when you ask them, what sort of responsibilities do you think your organization should have in addressing these issues versus how do you think climate change will impact those issues versus what level of responsibility they currently have, you can see some really interesting numbers here that you can start to address by intervening. But you have to do the diagnostics of understanding what a workforce is thinking across an organization in the context of climate change. Next slide. And so that means what we ultimately have to do is build organizational climate change readiness. We're not going to get there with one or two people in an organization with thousands or tens of thousands of employees. We have to think about this systemically. We have to build a culture that addresses attitudes, perceptions, and behaviors, as well as will. We have to strengthen governance to make sure that we have good structures, performance expectations, job descriptions, and existing capabilities. And ultimately, we have to learn how are we going to institutionalize climate change into decision-making across planning, policy, and operations, and work towards transforming our culture through literacy, awareness, and training programs. Next slide. So that brings us to the end. And I want to point out one really important market signal that helps us make these investments in human capital. Standard & Poor's, or S&P, did their credit rating affirmation of Charles County, Maryland, which is a small rural community in Maryland, about a year and a half ago. And upon learning that the county had required 25 of its senior personnel to go through 6 days of training administered through the Maryland Climate Leadership Academy, which we run, they used that as a substantiation of saying, this is a county that is very strongly managed, and we're going to give them a AAA rating because they're taking this issue seriously. And we have confidence that they're going to tackle their vulnerabilities in the context of climate change. It's important to note that the credit rating agencies have already come out and said that they will hold national and subnational governments and corporate entities accountable in the context of credit ratings if they don't believe they are taking sufficient action to address climate risk. So we see a market signal there. We just need to figure out how to amplify that signal. So with that, I encourage you to keep in touch. Feel free to reach out to me. Thank you all to the economics team for inviting me today. And I will stick around as much as possible to participate in dialogue, but we have a training coming up at 9:00 a.m. this morning.
Thank you so much, Mr. Krieger. Maybe if I could summarize a bit on what Mr. Krieger has talked about tonight. He brought a lot of interesting point of view in terms of bringing climate education into professionals in many different fields, which is something that is rarely talked about, but is something that obviously is very, very important. He talked a little bit about the history of the UNCCC, about how there is no mandatory reductions, no enforcement mechanisms, and also from Kyoto to Paris, how Kyoto was never going to be enough, and how Paris was more of a bottoms-up approach, and how that's panning out. One thing that I think is very, very important that was discussed is how investment in climate smart workforce is key. And I think that's the raison d'etre for ECHO, right? Where different roles need to have different levels of awareness, knowledge and competency on climate change and get that into the decision-making process. And I think the survey results that you brought up is also very, very interesting, that there is a massive gap between people claiming that we need to reduce footprints versus whether they would do anything about it. And to some extent, I'm guessing this sort of gap might exist in country level as well, like policy making as well. Everyone agrees we need to do something about climate change, but whether or not they, you know, put their skin in the game to do something about it is totally different matter, right, Mr. Krieger?
Thank you.
Yeah.
You know, it's a quick note. Yeah. Marsha McFira put a question in the Q&A box. I'd encourage her to resend it because I meant to try and type a response and I accidentally clicked on the answer live. So Marsha, if you'll kindly repost it, I'll post a response to it. Sorry about that.
Sure. All right. Thanks again, Mr. Krieger. We move on to our second speaker, Professor Edwin Aldrian. Time is yours, Prof, 20 minutes.
Can I use my screen to share? Okay, this is my screen. Okay, everybody, can I start now? You may start now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. You may start.
Okay. My name is Edwin Aldrian. I'm working in the BBPT as a professor of meteorology and climatology. I also work for IPCC as IPCC working group and vice chair. I will look at the long-term objective of Paris Agreement and the climate science perspective. Okay, what is IPCC as my I'm joining now? It is a international specialized body under United Nations which deal with climate change science. So established 1979, and also it established the establishment of the UNFCCC. It's under the endorsement of World Meteorological Organization and UN Environment Program. So major product is a assessment report. The first assessment report goes to establishment of the UNFCCC. The second assessment report goes to the Kyoto Protocol. And the fourth assessment report has received the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. And fifth assessment report led to the Paris Agreement. So this is the story of the. So there are 34 members of the bureau. I'm also part of that. This is me and as representing the country in the Southwest Pacific and Southeast Asia. And then I'm in the second Indonesian to be in this matter. So I also here introduce expert of Indonesia working on the IPCC in this cycle. The first one is like this one is Dwi Susanto working in the Maryland in the United States. And then some people are from the Sumatra, Java, also Borneo and Celebes also work for the IPCC under current stand. So as noted by the United Nations that we try to deliver all service into one language. Right now, the UN try to accommodate everything in the Sustainable Development Goals, or SDG. And part of that, climate change is number 13 goals. So we, in this report, we try to suffice the needs of all other Sustainable Development Goals. So as already explained before, So the Kyoto Protocol also already adopted in 1997, and the main target is the world go back to the 1990 emission. So there are country divided into Annex 1 world and then non-Annex 1, and also as already explained that US didn't sign the protocol and function as observer can also give opinion or something like that. For the Paris Agreement, it's established in 2015. So unlike the Kyoto Protocol, which is established by legally binding emission target, so for Paris Agreement, not only for the responsible country, but also everyone, rich, poor, developed, and developing country, they must do their part. So the aim is right now is for simplicity, is try to reach balance in emission for everybody in 2050. So 2050, everybody can have a balance in their calculation. So this is the main difference in Kyoto Protocol and Paris Agreement. We're not aiming for a specific date, and also aiming to balance economic carbon economy in 2050. So it is decarbonation of global economic activity. So it will take place under the measure of we make the global stock take. Global stock take is the periodic measurement, because every country has done the voluntary emission reduction, and also through the MRV, measurable, reportable, and verifiable. So it is an intentional determined national contribution under the UNFCCC national communication. Each country can establish how many mitigation they want to achieve. It is also national inventory registry, and then we're doing so with the IPCC emission factor. Therefore, working group in IPCC to reach that. So for perspective of Indonesian economy, it is said in that Indonesian economy will reach number 4 with $10,000 trillion, and then in 2050 the world population may reach $9.8 billion people. Now is 7.8. So Indonesia expected to have 366 million people. We try to develop a new green technology to ensure long-term global growth, which is environmentally sustainable. So in 2050, we try to reach a balanced status, and the global stocktake try to monitor by UNFCCC and then by IPCC. Because IPCC monitor this global stocktake by looking at the current emission factor and the global temperature. And then the global stocktake will take place firstly in the 2030, 3 years from now, and then will after that it will start every 5 years with the MRV system, measurable, reportable, and verifiable. It is possible that we'll reach overshoot, because this is very short period. Everybody will likely to start in 2030. We hopefully reach temperature below 2 degrees and possibly 1.5 degrees. This is a very important note, that the current international voluntary emission target, that INDC, National Determined Contribution, only contribute 1/3 of the common goal to the reach 1.5 degree target. So we have to move harder and harder for everyone to contribute voluntarily. So we have to plan that we need to take action beyond 2030. It's something that is this is this may be the simple emission story that on the left is a southern hemisphere, on the right is northern hemisphere. Usually the northern hemisphere take away the higher emission target. This is CO2 concentration. The world now has more than 30 places to measure this greenhouse gas concentration. So you can see here, I think you can see the history of global greenhouse gases in the internet, and you find this place. Okay, I will skip this. I'm sorry, I have to skip this. Okay, then for UNFCCC and the IPCC goal, so the what is with the action that we make for the water sector? For example, there are some problem with water sector. First one is unequal water distribution, shortage of short and not during dry season, extreme weather and climate event, and capacity to recycle water to water storage. This is happen everywhere. This is a story. For example, I'm lacking the heat spell in the Indian subcontinent. The temperature could reach 50 degrees Celsius in northern India, and then the problem with climate and food. I think this is more even problematic. Because arable land availability, desertification, and land degradation and land use change. The problem in Indonesia is land use change. IPCC now just finished last year this kind of report of land problem of the climate change. Food energy crisis, plant tree, you plant tree for food or energy. This is problem with Indonesia right now. You plant palm oil, it is for food or for energy. I'll be questioned that. And then sustainability of food production, how to feed large population, enough water, waste capacity, and for equality. This is some example of news. China spent 60,000 soldiers to plant trees. And also we can see that this is happening in Thailand, also the same story. And also this is Pakistan plant over 1 billion trees. We don't see Indonesia putting their army to plant trees right now. But I think it's the movement is almost everywhere. Now the climate and energy sector. This is a problem with energy security. You need to exit strategy for fossil fuel. I think everybody in a problem right now to replace fossil fuel with some other renewable energy. Ocean and renewable energy development, clean and renewable energy, and also transforming energy for industry and transportation sector. This is a big challenge to everyone because want to put more car in the transportation sector, but in other mean that they have to change into fossil fuel. You can see that in news that some city in Europe they trying to. In some country, they want to get rid of fossil fuel car. This is, I think, this is a big problem for climate, and also increasing city and country are burning fossil fuel, burning for car. I see that Copenhagen is one of the city, and other city starting to follow up the situation, and then they don't want to have a burning fossil fuel car in the. Big city in the inner city. Country around the world are racing to phase out gasoline and diesel car. This is a big problem in the world right now. Look at this. Germany to shutter all 84 coal plan to fight climate change. This is happening everywhere. And many countries in the Europe also want to shut down coal energy plan to fight climate change. Okay, last problem is climate change and environment. This is an environment problem. Like Indonesia, we have problem with peatland and other carbon soil problem, such as palm oil, and then forest fire and other black carbon problem. And so to increase replantation, as I already shown before in the news. Okay, let's move to the report. The IPCC has produced a report in 2018. Understanding the global warming 1.5 degree. So now we already see the consequence of global warming. So at the current rate, it will be 1.5 in between. If it is good, manageable, I think between 2030 until we're doing nothing, it is 2052. And the past emission does not follow what we already now contribute. So because the long-term emission of is causing the problem. So if you understand that climate change potential event projection, right now there's if you compare the 1.5 into 2 degree increase, the less extreme weather will take place and people can live in by 2100 that the global sea level rise can be 10 centimeter lower if you have 1.5 degree rather than 2 degree. And less than 10 billion people will migrate if their life is risking by 2 degree if they compare to 1.5 degree. So less impact in biodiversity and species. Right now, IPCC working with IPBES to make a special report on this issue. Smaller reduction of yield maize rice with harvest. I don't know about situation in Indonesia. You know. The global population exposed to increased water shortage up to 50% or less if you have 1.5 degree to compare to 2 degree. So lower the fish catch and then up to several hundred people exposed to modern climate related risk and susceptibility to poverty by 2050. So this is for greenhouse gas emission pathway. So if you limit warming compared to 2 degree, you have to limit reduction of emission will have the immediate health benefit. This is already first speaker already talk about that. Also, limiting 1.5 degree would require change at unprecedented scale. You have to do not you. I think the whole group of the whole community of the world. You have to do deep cut emission in our sector, and also you have to make choice of range of technology, whether fossil fuel or whether some other clean energy or something else. You have to do behavioral change. I think instead of choosing big car, if you drive alone, you choosing a small car and then recycle, reduce, and reuse. Also, you must increase investment in low carbon option. This is some of the IPCC suggestion for this. Okay, progress in renewable energy. Because renewable energy is a fast progress forward, so it will be mirror to other sector. So we would start taking carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. This is big issue right now, to start taking carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, not to adding more, but we take more carbon dioxide. So implication for food sector ecosystem and biodiversity. So I will give some example later on. So the pledges or the national contribution is not enough. I said before, it is you require 3 times because you what you already say is only 1/3 of the required one. Avoiding warming is more than 1.5 will require substantive decline before 2030. So what happened to people? Because all the UN report must have something to do with sustainable development goals. And then measure the adaptation, and then national and subnational, like first speaker also say, not only government, but civil society and so on like that. So we need international cooperation because the victim is everyone, everybody vulnerable, everyone is victim. So we need an international cooperation as a critical part of the limiting warming to 1.5 degrees. So IPCC, in this report, IPCC 1.5 degree, has already give option, four option to reduce up to 2050. This is starting in the 2030 until 2050. We try to reach emission mitigation option. So based on very simple, this is very simple. You make reduction of a fossil fuel, and then you make control of the AFOLU, it is land use change. And then the yellow one is, this is bioenergy and carbon capture and storage. You only control these three things, and then you will have a separate option for the development. This is option one, option two, option three, option four. This is some of the calculation. I think this is too small to see the font here. But I think in this case, IPCC has the temperature emission energy system target and carbon dioxide emission and agriculture sector. Here, a good news, this is a MIT engineer. Just recently, they already say that they already find a new battery that works by removing carbon dioxide straight from the air. This is good news. I think something like this, the technology that remove carbon dioxide from air, we need more technology like this in the future. And this technology also give you energy. This is a battery technology. And this is also an airplane that that fly by electricity, by battery. I think now I heard that Israeli, they have a small medium airplane to up to nine passenger can use a battery like this. So I think it's good news. So for the relationship between energy supply and energy demand with the SDG, this is SDG 1 to 8. You can see that there's a option what happened with the if we take option like that, this is also from land use, energy supply, energy demand, and land use. For the this one is for the next sustainable development goal up to development goal number 17, except number 13 because 13 is the climate itself. So for Indonesia prospect in energy beyond 2050. My suggestion is that right now we are much rely on renewable, except for bioenergy. Right now we rely on the bioenergy, like 100%. You can make gasoline from the palm oil and so on. For IPCC report, we say that the bioenergy is only intermediary report, intermediary solution. We need more renewable energy. I think for case of Indonesia, we must rely on the geothermal and ocean technology for ocean engineering for energy. So geothermal, because Indonesia have a lot of volcano, many volcano everywhere in the land area in the ocean. So I think last one, this is my news. I make an article, this in Kompas 30 October 2018. This is give you as a report of IPCC report 1.5. I already make an article in Kompas for this one. Okay, thank you very much, everyone. I will stop here. I think you can continue. I think we can discuss more about this. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Prof. Edwin. So a little bit of what, a little bit to summarize what Edwin has talked about recently. So the IPCC is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, specialist body from the United Nations on climate change, whose major products include assessments and studies that has led to major agreements such as the Kyoto and Paris agreements that we're discussing tonight. One of the key things that Prof. Edwin mentioned tonight is the importance of having a measurable, reliable, and verifiable goals when it comes to dealing with climate change, where the aim is to achieve balanced status by 2050, and some countries and everyone needs to take action beyond 2030. Prof. Edwin also talked about how some cities in many different parts of the world has different plans to ditch fossil fuel cars. Some countries are rushing to ditch coal and fossil fuel based plans, for example, and talked about the importance of international cooperation in dealing with climate crisis. Prof. Edwin also mentioned four pathways or options with differences in scenarios in controlling fossil fuels, land use changes, et cetera. And at last, I think Prof. Edwin mentioned that for Indonesia, I think the focus should be on geothermal and ocean energy that we're in abundance of. So we can move on to our third speaker, Prof. Budi Rasasudarmo. 20 minutes, Prof. The time is yours.
Sorry. Good night, everyone. Thanks for inviting me to this event. So my presentation is more on encouraging you to think about policy that could be implemented in Indonesia based on the structure of the issue, and second is based on our implementation, our experience in implementing policy reform, particularly related to economic and environmental policy reform. So I'm not going to tell you much, but I would like you to encourage you to think about this issue. Although our intention is good, but sometimes we cannot achieve it. So there are references that I provide to you. So this presentation based on my previous work. As Pa Edwin has mentioned before, that Indonesia has this nationally determined NDC published in 2016. And I think also Edwin has mentioned that the promise is that by 2030, Indonesia will voluntarily reduce its emission by 20% compared to business as usual, and up to 41% with international assistance. So I'm not going to talk much about this because Edwin has mentioned this. And also it has been mentioned before that Indonesia is among the top 10 global emitter, and if you can see that the bigger part of our emission come from forestry, and the smaller part come from fossil fuel combustion. So even if this only from fossil fuel combustion, we are still among the top 20 global emitter. So Indonesia position is not so good, and so we need to do something and to be able to contribute to the better situation globally. Okay, so what is the issue that Indonesia is facing? In my opinion, as follow. Yes, this is a sketch. It's not really a real number, but to illustrate what are the issues that Indonesia face, and in general, what strategy that we need to do dealing with this CO2 emission. As I mentioned before, that the main source of Indonesia emission, CO2 emission, come from a land use change and deforestation. Yeah, so these are about right the level of emission from land use change and forestry, and this is the other one that lower come from fossil fuel. So since the land use change and forestry are bigger, it is obvious that we need to pay attention on those sources. And so what we want is that we could control forest fire, we could better manage forest conversion, and we could rehabilitate peatland. And so the path that we go in the near, in the future will be this downslope emission from land use and forestry. So that is probably an ideal, and everybody would like to do it. And with this path, we also have sustainable forests. We still have large forests and it is sustainable because we are able to control forest fire, forest conversion, and we have been able to rehabilitate peatland. However, it is also remember that this is not good, but could happen that we fail to manage land use change and deforestation. In that case, our emission will keep high for a certain period of time, but after that, eventually, it will decline. But this decline most likely since we do not have forests much anymore. So this is how long this decline will happen, we don't really know, depending how worse our forest management is and will be in the future. So this is basically the story of emission come from land use change and forestry. Now, what happened with fossil fuel? Well, with fossil fuel, it just eventually it will just keep growing. Emission from fossil fuel is set to keep growing as the economy is growing. So business as usual, you probably will have a continuation of increase, and eventually it will be even higher than forestry. And the structure of this path is actually being locked for a long time, because investment, the bigger part of this is electricity, investment on electric power generation is at least 50 years investment. So if you already built a coal power plant, it will have to stay for about 50 years to get the return back. So a lot of this electricity is being set for a long time. So now it is important then to actually change the path of this electricity. And if you start late, you still can reduce it, but you might not be able to reduce as much as if you start as soon as possible. So if you start increasing renewable energy as soon as possible, you could have a much better path comparing to if you have to wait for next 20 years. These are the two characters of emission that come from forestry and fossil fuel. So the main message is that, you know, being able to control all sources of emission is important. Yeah, if you being able to control emission from deforestation is important, However, it is also important to be able to control emission from fossil fuel. Now, if we can, certainly what we want is that we reduce deforestation and land degradation and bring fossil fuel into a lower trajectory and starting soon make a big difference over time. So that's what we want. But in reality, we might not be able to deliver all of this. So what I encourage you to start thinking, be practical, work on sources where we can make the most significant progress, although we certainly should not ignore difficult issue. But being able to being practical on which source of emission you need to handle is important. So important to think for the young generation is that workable strategy. Yeah. You have all these sources, think about what is work right now, and you could actually make the most significant progress while keeping up, while keep monitoring the difficult one. Yeah. So it is probably not strategic to handle all at the same time. You know, well, Indonesia is a great country, but certainly we have limited capabilities. Now, the other aspect that I would like to mention in this presentation is that it is also important to understand environmental policy that could work. Yeah. Very few environmental policy and even very few economic reform is actually work in Indonesia and many developing countries. So we need to understand what are the character of an implementation of a certain policies that could work. So let's go to some of our more successful case study. Now, before looking at those case study, I would like to summarize the lesson that we have learned from this successful story. Well, in general, there are several points. One important point is that, unfortunately, it needs crisis to make a reform successful so far. So Pak Sadli was famous of saying that good policy typically come at a bad time. Yeah. Because some of our successful policy actually come just after the crisis. However, there are several other requirements. One is a solid domestic research linked with international research agency, national political support, institutional breakthrough, international support, appropriate implementation mechanism, relatively quick direct benefit to target groups. So I will describe this in a more detail. So I will choose two reform. One is the not environmental policy reform, but our 1980s economic reform. The other one is integrated pest management program. So this is the integrated management program was targeted to reduce the use of pesticide that because of green revolution by mid-1990s already so bad. Yeah. About 30% of our farmers basically got poisoned because of the use of this pesticide. So the government tried to implement a much more environmental friendly method in cultivating particularly rice by implementing what's so called integrated pest management. And that was considered success, although not for a long time, for a short period of time, in the mid-1990s, and it was becoming an example for many developing countries. So Although the program has to stop because of the financial crisis in 1997. The other one is an older program, which is Indonesian Economic Reform in 1980s. This the main reason for that is that there was a drop in oil price, so there's a big shock, and the economy could collapse. So by the way, the IPM, because of the use of this pesticide, there's another crisis besides health problem, is this pest outbreak. So the pest becoming resistant to the pesticide. So instead of this pesticide kill the pest actually booming, becoming so big and destroy rice plantation. So these are the two case studies that I would like to describe. And the characteristic of this situation is that, as you know, the economic reform in 1990s was architected by FAOE economists, which is called the Berkeley Group, who relatively recently come back from top university in US and got a strong link with international research communities. So it is important that we have this group that relatively have very strong connection with good research in the US, because the main people in this group come from the top university in the US, where the top research on economics is actually happening. Now, that's something to remember. If any of you going to go to postgraduate studies, go to top universities. Now, on the IPM, Indonesia Agricultural Research has been one of the longest research groups. So it has been happening during the Dutch. It has been very strong in Ministry of Agriculture. And we have a particularly university dealing with agriculture, IPB, and also UGM was strong on agriculture. And these three groups are connected, and they actually have a strong link with international organizations such as FAO, who conduct, or IRI, who conduct strong research on rice. So then, there was this crisis. There was a panic in the case of economic reform, and there was a panic that oil price dropped. At that time, in 1970s, about 80% of government revenue came from oil and gas. So imagine when the price of oil dropped, then suddenly the government do not really have revenue, because government revenue dropped significantly. So that was a panic at the time. While the IPM, has been mentioned, the panic was this outbreak of pests destroy 1,000 hectares of rice field in Java, threatening our food security issue. So those two things. And on the economic reform, the Berkeley Group, come up with some suggestion, basically trade liberalization and financial liberalization, or at the time was called economic structural adjustment. While the IPM, in the issue of pest outbreak, this group of scientists in MOA, IPB and UGM suggest that we need to implement integrated pest management, basically reducing the use of pesticide and use more natural enemy to kill the pest. Now, those ideas could not be implemented if there is no support from the president. So in the case of economic reform, at that time, Pak Harto set up an impress to reduce tariff and do financial liberalization, as well as to resolve the problem of non-tariff issue, which is slow movement in the Indonesia duana or Indonesia port for import and export. Now on the IPM, it's almost the same. The president also set up an impress that basically saying that everybody need to support the implementation of IPM. Now, remember the presidential impress at that time is very strong. It's backed up by the military, backed up by all government agency. Yeah, so it's guaranteed that it will implement. But it is not happening, could not happening if there is this administration breakthrough is not happening. In the case of IPM, there was a resistance by people in the Ministry of Agriculture to implement IPM, mostly because many of their higher officials are member of the commissioners in pesticide company. So at that time, to make it workable, the president decided Bappenas do this implementation of IPM. So bypassing the Ministry of Agriculture. The same thing do the problem in the port administration. The Berkeley Group suggests that we just hire a private company to manage our port and export-import administration. So bypassing, in a way, the Ministry of Finance. So that actually something that important. Now, international support in implementing this policy happened in the case of economic reform is from Harvard International Institute of Development, while from IPM, the support come from FAO, particularly on the technical support detailing all this policy. The mechanism to implement this policy is clear. This is tariff and non-tariff barrier relief. And in the case of IPM, we conducted farmer field school to teach farmer in implementing the IPM program. And the benefit of this policy is relatively quick. In the case of economic reform, we could see directly that the non-oil sector actually growing up very fast. While in the IPM, farmers' income directly increase when they implement the IPM program. So these characters are important for Indonesia, I would argue important for Indonesia to be successful in implementing environmental policy. One, you need strong domestic research that connected to international research institution. Well, two, unfortunately, there's a crisis. Three, it is important to have political support, and this should come from the number one person in the country. We unfortunately need an administration breakthrough. International support in the implementation is important. Clear mechanism in implementing the policy and direct benefit should be fast. So this back to this point, if we could, certainly we could implement this without crisis. So that is probably ideal for us. Now, let's see what happened with Indonesian climate change considering this issue. Let me go quick through Yudhoyono presidency. Yeah. So Indonesia holds in 2007, when Indonesia hold COP in Bali, global attention was given to Indonesia, and everybody said that, look, Indonesia is among the top five at the time. You know, and Indonesia doesn't seem to do anything. to a lot of pressure that asking Indonesia to do something on its emission. It was in a way, diplomatically, it was a crisis for Indonesia. And the president reacted by giving his commitment. Yeah, this is probably the first time that Indonesia gave a commitment in G20 Leader Summit in Pittsburgh. Said that we're going to reduce our emission 20%, 26% below business as usual by 2020 and up to 41% with international addition. The other thing that respond is that he added environment in his development mantras, which become pro-growth, pro-job, pro-poor, and pro-environment. And also, the president want to build a legacy of his presidency as a leader among developing nations on the issue of climate change. There was a big push and national support because the president want to have this is happening. And we can see that there are progress that relatively quick and significant involving several organization institution in Indonesia, Ministry of Environment, Bappenas, National Council of Climate Change, Ministry of Forestry, Ministry of Finance, and Presidential Unit, UKP4, in September 2010, RED and Task Force was established. We do the first moratorium on forest conversion, continue again the second time, and also progress in setting up establishing REDD agency happening within 2 years. And this is happening despite that there are resistance, there were resistance from several institutions, and challenges were huge in setting up these things. Everybody think that it's just impossible to set up an REDD agency, but that was happened. Issues regarding the reducing deforestation and forest degradation, however, plenty. These include serious issue regarding land tenure. Yeah, so this is still an issue up until now. Competition from other land-based short-term economic development, such as oil palm, other food crops, and mineral extraction. Weak forest governance and governance in general. International support was not able, sorry, this is supposed to be what not able to push the process. And the issue remained till now. On the energy sector, however, cabinet cannot really do much. Research exists on energy, but relatively limited. Energy policy, Ministry of Energy still hang on the old energy mix strategy, which is coal is actually still very high. Significant fuel subsidy. Coal power plant in response to electricity shortage, carbon tax is considered but never really implemented. In the Pak Jokowi presidency, he did remove gasoline subsidy in 2015 and set a fixed subsidy for diesel and kerosene. This is probably the biggest climate change policy that we ever did. And the impact could be significant. But however, by now, energy subsidy still a big issue. He merged Ministry of Environment with Ministry of Forestry, and in a way, and inserted REDD agency and National Council on Climate Change into the new Ministry of Environment and Forestry. In a way, it's downgrade the importance of climate change issue within his cabinet, although he established peatland restoration that directly responsible to him. as a substitute of REDD agency. Recently, he announced permanent moratorium on clearance of primary forest and peatland. However, he supported food estate and biofuel program that could be a threat for deforestation. The other issue is environment is not in his nawacita, not like SBY that environment is part of SBY development mantra. And if we look at the energy, at the moment, actually, there is a good opportunity. The price of solar power has been declined since 2010 significantly. And in India, it has been as low as 3.7 cents per kilowatt hour. Although Indonesia, the cutoff is still 7.66. So we need to work more, but the opportunity is there. To actually transfer to solar cell. However, comparing to other countries, including developing countries, Indonesia power mix or renewable solar and wind is relatively very, very small. Yeah, and India, for example, has been close to 5%. So looking at that, comparing what happened during SBY Jokowi, we don't really know whether we do have relatively solid domestic research linked to international research group on climate change. Crisis and Jokowi don't have really international pressure that asking us to do much, as high as what SBY has to face at the time because we host the COP 2007. National support, SBY clearly put climate change is in his mantra, development mantra. Nawacita do not really mention that. Institutional support, yes, UKP 4 or the presidential office directly manage the issue of climate change. In Jokowi, we don't really know. There is a peatland restoration agency, but how whether it's as strong as the UKP 4 group, it's questionable. International support, yes and no. International people is always trying to push Indonesia to work more. However, whether we have decide appropriate mechanism, that's still an issue. REDD program certainly progressing, but it's not yet at the form that we really want. The renewable energy, we still far behind. Yeah. And the other important things is that whether we could actually see the relatively quick benefit for people that are affected by this policy is not clear as well. So in the final remark, I would like to say Indonesia is among the largest contribution of emission. That's the fact. However, developing climate change policy and environmental policy in general is complex and difficult process involving various agencies with different objectives. And you do need to have some requirement that I have been mentioned in this presentation. During the SBY presidency, Indonesia did make significant progress. Jokowi, in one hand, never formally set up climate change as his top priority and has set back some progress. On the other hand, make some progress as well. However, I would like to argue that during this presidency, progress in managing climate change in Indonesia has been slow and a lot still could be done. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Prof. Budi. So a little bit on what Prof. Budi has talked about earlier today. So Prof. Budi talked a lot about climate change policies, economic and environmental policy reform. Indonesia's NDC is 29% reduction by 2030 from the business as usual. Indonesia's emissions are mostly from deforestation, whereas other top CO2 emitters are mostly from energy and industry, although this might change sometime in the future. Note to all of us, future policymakers, be practical with policymaking, work where you can make the most significant progress. I think that's one good takeaway for all of you today. He mentioned the importance of a few things: national political support, institutional breakthrough, international support, appropriate implementation mechanism, and relatively quick direct benefit for target groups. And in the end, he made some comparisons between the SBY and Jokowi administrations. Before we go into the Q&A, I'd like to mention that Daniel Krieger will not be able to stay until the Q&A sessions tonight. He has left the event. Daniel, if you're watching this on recording, we'd like to extend our thanks to you for sharing with us and for answering all the questions addressed on the Q&A tool here. So there are a lot of questions that have been answered on the Q&A platform by Daniel. So thanks a lot for that. And we really, really appreciate it. We will move on to the Q&A session, but before that, I'd like to use my moderator privilege and ask the first question, if I may, to the panelists, Prof. Budi or Prof. Edwin. One of the many points of contention when discussing climate policy or climate action is nuclear energy, and I don't think that's been talked about today. Proponents maintain it's the most efficient and green technology available right now, and with new development, risks should be well mitigated. I'm just curious what your thoughts are on climate on nuclear energy as a greener source of energy going forward. Maybe Prof. Edwin first.
Yes, thank you very much. My opinion on nuclear energy, I think the current technology is the fuel cell. It is very rapid and easily accessible. So people like this energy rather than energy that bring. So the problem with energy is it is not portable enough. So if you want to have energy with a small car and so on, you need a portable and lighter. So basically, you need energy to be last longer. So basically, what you want is something like a nuclear super reactor. This is the contrast of this theory. You want something really like this thing, but you don't like this thing, the nuclear power. Unless you have a power to control it you don't have any more question. So what happened with the last one with Fukushima really teach us, because Fukushima is something that people really control and really save. So right now nuclear is mainly abundant in Europe country. But what you need is like right now is a fusion and fission at the cold temperature. It is like a nuclear itself. So you want something very small, but something very big in power. Or maybe you need something perpetual. That means can last longer. So as it is a perpetual, it is like a self combined like self producing energy. It is like nuclear power. So you dream something like nuclear power, but I think the problem is you want to control it. I think this is a basic problem with the energy. You know that there is a energy, it's like hydrogen power. Hydrogen power is something like fission and fission. So by the end, I will say that let be it. I mean, if you can control nuclear energy, if you can control, like you put in a place, somewhere place in Indonesia. First one is in Jepara. I think I was in this location to study. And then after that in Kalimantan and then in Bangka Belitung. If you find a place to run the nuclear power safely, and then you can, I think you can put the waste into some other location. Maybe you can dig a 3 kilometer, 10 kilometer, which is safe for the earthquake and so on. I think what else you can complain about? I think you depend on technology. Everything is depend on technology. I think you may fail somehow in the future. But if we say that nuclear power is no emission, it is also not correct. If someone asks here, the battery technology is not free from pollution. Of course, when you harvest or when you explore the nickel, cadmium and so on like that, you will give pollution to the environment. So nothing is free for pollution. But if you can control it under your control, I think let's go for it. I think that is my answer. Thank you.
Thank you, Pak. We move on to questions from the attendees. I think this one can be addressed to Prof. Budi. This is from Marsha Magvira. From what I understand, climate change can be mitigated, but it can never stop. Do you think building resilience to the society by implementing climate change adaptation is equally crucial with the mitigation itself? I believe preparing the future generation to face the unavoidable impact of climate change is critically important. However, this doesn't seem like a popular opinion among decision makers. Prof. Budi, yeah.
Yeah, of course, building resilience is important. But the idea of that we cannot stabilize the global temperature is a bit too pessimistic. So certainly we need to balance between adaptation and mitigation. Nationally, we need to keep thinking about how to make good progress and in mitigating climate change. However, a lot of local efforts should be conducted in helping people to adapt with all these changes. And I guess I understand why this question raised, because most of the time when we talk about climate change, it's about mitigation. And for a country like Indonesia, it's actually important to boost more the issue on helping people to adapt with the change. Well, there are reasons for that, because everybody at the moment, all countries are having an argument that you need to contribute on reducing this emission. But nationally, certainly we need to put also important to put adaptation in among the top priority as well. So, but I agree that pushing toward having a strong program and adaptation is still far. Yeah. So for example, in economics, we probably should start thinking about insurance as a mechanism to softening up all this impact, and research or work on insurance for natural disaster is relatively weak. I agree, and I do not reject the suggestion to increase the importance of adaptation.
Prof. Edwin, maybe you want to jump in, Prof?
Yes, I think the climate crisis is damaging the our modality to live. So people can stay in the 50 temperature Celsius above zero, and people can stay at 50 degree minus temperature below zero. I think people can survive on that. It's not the climate itself, but the modality to survive, it is become limited. The modality for the land use, for food, for energy and so on, by the changing of temperature, it is all becoming limited. So this is the problem with us. I think we need to survive in this matter, whether by adaptation or mitigation. So in the future, we will face a lot of problem with what happened with the palm oil right now. We will face a fast threat barrier by some other country to us. I think if we don't tackle this problem of climate crisis, it will become even more. We now facing the European Union parliamentary resolution on palm oil. They don't like our palm oil because of, they don't like our palm oil, not because of that, because of we burn the forest. That is our management of land use change. So again, because we need palm oil. I think we have palm oil. We can do whatever with palm oil. But the thing with the climate change is affecting many countries. If we burn a forest in us, then many other countries will be affected. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay. Prof. Edwin, I think there is this next question is best answered by you from Rus Ebara GL from the University of Indonesia. Based on the current and likely trajectories, is some form of geoengineering necessary to buy time? What are the considerations to apply geoengineering, and what are the differences in the politics of geoengineering compared with the politics of emissions reductions? I think you've answered this on the platform, but I think maybe you can elaborate more a bit on what geoengineering is and what your thoughts are on it.
Yes, thank you. I think many people, many scientists in IPCC, they don't like geoengineering. They don't like because we don't see any foreseeable future. The longer or near term of the, if something we modify the Earth system, like we put iron in the ocean, maybe in one area it will be good, useful, but in some other area it become harmful. So we don't know exactly the whole picture. So if China have or Russia might put a mirror in the space to let the agriculture work at the night time, so maybe it work for one place, maybe it not doesn't work for other time. So I think we don't see we receive this system by God who designed this climate engineering. The system designed by God, so we want to intervene something we don't know what is the impact on the foreseeable future. So unless we know everything, and then let's go ahead with that. Thank you very much. If you're talking geoengineering, the people always say about the volcanic eruption. So many people know that the Gunung Galunggung, Gunung Tambora, Gunung what is Krakatoa has a lot of impact until other part of the world. So this what people think about geoengineering. If we can make something like that similar to volcanic eruption, we can make something very useful. Because after the volcanic eruption, for example, Krakatoa, the world temperature going down. So if we can make something like that similar, we can make geoengineering like that. But I don't think we don't know.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Edwin. The next question is from Hegar Egyara of the University of Indonesia. I think this might be addressed to Prof. Budi. Ecological conservation tends to be financed by big central government powers, which builds unsustainable reliance on faraway power and reduces decentralization efforts that increases social welfare in the long run. With that in mind, are there examples of efforts made by communities to achieve development without resorting to environmental exploitation or over-reliance from central government powers? This is a very FAOE question.
So I think Indonesia is a kind of a bit late in actually boosting the use of solar panel. I mean, comparing, as I mentioned in slide, compared to India, the share of our electricity based on solar and wind is much smaller than India. So, well, there are some technical reason for that, something that I do not know, but that is the fact that we see. And also India has been able to lower the cost of its solar electricities, while Indonesia has not really been able to do so. Our wind in South Sulawesi is still cost, I think, about 10 to 12 cents per kilowatt hour, you know, compared to the last India bidding for a solar park, already 3 cents per kilowatt hour. So there are actually examples on this community development in providing power supply. They actually work in some other countries. So in an example in Australia, solar roof panel is booming. Almost everyone is actually putting solar panel at the moment. And so understanding more why this is not happening in Indonesia is important. There is an article that I and several friends trying to summarize the issues that as some of the regulation need to be lifted, but also I guess the resistance of Ministry of Energy to move quickly toward solar panel is also an issue that we need to learn more. But answering the question is that yes, in other people, this movement is happening. Development of renewable energy based on community, but we yet to see that is happening in Indonesia.
All right. Thanks. Probably Prof. Edwin,
In addition that you must understand that the energy for domestic in Indonesia is pretty much controlled by PLN. PLN is the sole monopolized agency for supplying the electricity for domestic use for people they need. So I think unless we give a little bit leeway in the law, and like for example in Germany, that the solar power and the roof, they can put into grid system. We already have this technology, but the regulation is still very much not like in that country. If we can make power by ourselves, every house, then the electricity become the bill become less. It's something like that doesn't happen in Indonesia. So people interest on this technology maybe is not growing. So we must know that the monopoly for the energy for domestic sector is still by single company right now in Indonesia. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Edwin. We actually have so many more questions on our Q&A platform that's been asked by our attendees. Thank you very much for that. But unfortunately, we are out of time. I'd like to ask Prof. Edwin and Prof. Budi both each to give 1 minute final remarks or final closing statements, please.
Okay, thank you. I think when I came to Tasmania, it's a certain part of Australia. I was greeted by the Prime Minister of Tasmania. He said, he's a lady, a woman. She said that the problem of climate crisis is a problem not for us. This is a problem for generation to come, for our kids, for our grandchildren. If we make the earth is much more difficult to live by here, I think we owe to the next generation. I think we owe to our children. We owe to our grandchildren. I think we take something from they must have the best comfortable living. But we may take something from them because of this climate crisis. So let everyone think that if we make this not only for us, we make this for our children, for our grandchildren. We can make the earth as much as comfortable as we were born, not worse than we are living the world. So this is my message that the climate change is a common but differentiated problem. Well, this is common for everyone, but the solution is very different for everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Edwin. Prof. Budi?
Thank you very much. So based on my presentation, I think one of the most important message that I'm trying to convey is that if you look around globally, no environmental policy would be successful if it is not supported by the number one in a country. So you can see what happened in US, you can see what happened in other countries. So it is important to have the number one person in the country to be environmental friendly, to put environment in her or his top priority policy. Without that, it will be very difficult for an environmental policy to make a progress. So we have to wait, and we just hope that the current president will in a way change his priority and put environment as one of his point in Nawacita, or in the next election, remember that if you care about the environment, choose somebody that care about the environment as well, because without that, it is very difficult to implement environmental policy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof. Budi. Thank you very much, Prof. Edwin. I think that is that brings us to the end of our discussion tonight. It has been really fruitful. I've learned so much, and I hope every one of you that has attended this event feels the same way. So I think you'll give the floor back to the MC, Riano. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for everyone.
Thank you, Ryerson. Okay, as a form of gratitude, the 18 Economics would like to give our token of appreciation for our notable speakers and moderator presented by our Chief Executive Officer, Kevin Bagasatria.
Thank you, Riano, for the opportunity. Before handing our token of appreciation to the present speakers, I would like to thank Mr. Daniel Krieger for his very colorful presence in our discussion through his presentations and answers in the Q&A. Thank you very much, Mr. Daniel Krieger. Now, I call upon our second speaker, Prof. Edwin Aldrian. Dear Prof. Edwin, on behalf of the committee and the attendees, I would like to thank you for giving such an insightful presentation, especially from the climate scientist perspective that most of us like about. Please receive our e-certificate as our token of appreciation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Now, I call upon our third speaker, Prof. Budi Reso Sudarmo. Dear Prof. Budi, on behalf of the committee, I would like to thank you for the very insightful presentation regarding Indonesia's development surrounding the climate crisis. Please receive our e-certificate as a token of our gratitude. Thank you, Prof.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lastly, I call upon Mr. Nathaniel Reyes too. Dear Mr. Nathaniel Reyes too, thank you for handling this webinar very smoothly in such an engaging manner. Please receive our e-certificate as a token of appreciation. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
To commemorate this event, we will take a group picture. The picture will consist of all speakers, moderator, and our chief executive officer. Please all speakers and moderator to turn your camera. Ladies and gentlemen, we have finally reached the end of today's seminar. We really hope that today's seminar will give you beneficial knowledge, resulting in new ideas to overcome the global economic challenges. Thank you to our guest speakers and participants of the 18 Economix International Dialogue. Not to forget, we would also like to thank Kumparan, Liputan 6, Merdeka.com, Info Seminar, Event Campus, and last but not least, Kontan, as our media partner. I'm Thomas Cesariano. On behalf of the 18 Economix, we would like to bid you farewell. Espirit.
Liputan6.com dan aplikasi Liputan6 secara bersamaan. Semuanya ada di wajah baru aplikasi Liputan6. Kamu bisa jadi orang yang paling cepat dapat informasi terbaru karena ada fitur latest. Nikmati cara baru baca berita di fitur visual stories. Bukan cuma tulisannya yang menarik, tapi banyak gambar kece yang bisa kamu lihat. Tampilan kece, update berita cepat. Download sekarang ya.